Okay, recording is started, so let us begin. Today we will try to look at some of the basic components which you can use to build up an accelerator. This will include the source of the charge particle as well as different types of components which are used to either accelerate or guide the beam in different directions so that you can obtain the desired outcome with the beam. This is the basic layout of any, not any, but yeah, many modern accelerator laboratories. This is the layout of a modern accelerator facility. Basically, not every accelerator facility need to be like this, but this is quite typical. There will be a particle source which is somewhere near the center. Usually there is a DC type of extraction mechanism or a short DC voltage followed by a LINAC that is depicted by this straight section at the center. So particle source, initial acceleration or pre-acceleration, what is called as. Then there is a this is not necessary, but there can be a pre-acceleration. The acceleration can be in multiple stages. So there is one stage of acceleration here in a circular accelerator, and then a larger stage of acceleration here in another circular accelerator. In any circular accelerator, the acceleration is through a RF cavity of this type, which is shown here in red with kind of teeth type of thing, orange maybe. You are able to see this, right?
Yes, sir.
And the beam itself is depicted here as a blue colored thing. And this particular diagram is for a synchrotron radiation facility where the electron beam keeps bending through the magnets, but radiation is produced, which is being shown by yellow color, and that comes and falls within the different what you say beam lines, and the experiment can be done. Any large accelerator facility will have a experimental beam hall, an accelerator hall, and near the accelerator beam experimental beam hall there will be a system for data acquisition and means obtaining the parameters of the beam as well as the data from the experiment as close as possible. Maybe not necessarily like this, it is shown right next to each other, but as close as possible. The reason being that you don't you want to get the data into a storage as soon as possible, not passing through long wires where it will may get modified or something like that. I mean, it's straightforward enough. As close as possible to the beam hall, you have a or what is the experimental beam hall, you have a data acquisition, data storage kind of room, basically. And other than that, in this diagram, you can see red color are all bending magnets. You can see that the beam is bending from one and then it is going straight, again bending, going straight. So at each of these red colored bending magnets, the beam is bending. In addition, there are these green color objects which are focusing magnets, which are placed at a regular interval, as you can see. The reason for the regular interval will become clear when we discuss the transverse beam dynamics part. But right now, you can see that there are these green colored magnets, which are usually quadrupole magnets, and this red color one, which are dipole magnets, which are used for bending. This is a very typical layout. Sometimes there need not be a ring. There can be a DC accelerator and then directly a beam line. Multiple beam lines can be operated by using a bending magnet, which can have different beam deflections for different energies, so that you can set the magnetic field to take it in a different direction and use it from multiple beam lines. So basically, you have a source, you have some method of accelerating the beam, and then you have a mechanism to deliver the beam up to wherever the experiment is located. द बेसिक लेआउट ऑफ एनी मॉडर्न एक्सेलरेटर फैसिलिटी. ठीक है, दिस इज ए अनदर व्यू ऑफ ए सिमिलर फैसिलिटी सीन फ्रॉम टॉप. इज अगेन ए सिंक्रोट्रॉन फॉर इलेक्ट्रॉन बीम, एंड यू कैन सी दैट बेसिकली यू हैव ए इलेक्ट्रॉन गन विच इज द सोर्स ऑफ चार्ज पार्टिकल्स. इन दिस केस देर इज ए शॉर्ट लिनैक्स सेक्शन फॉर प्री एक्सेलरेटिंग द बीम बिफोर इंजेक्टिंग इन टू द रिंग, एंड देन इट इज इंजेक्टेड इन टू द रिंग, एंड एज इट सर्कुलेट्स इन द रिंग देर इज ए एक्सेलरेटिंग कैविटी ओवर हियर विच इज पावर्ड बाई समथिंग कॉल्ड ए क्लिस्ट्रॉन सोर्स विच इज ए पावर सोर्स बेसिकली. बॉटम लाइन, लेट्स नॉट गेट इन टू डिटेल्स. सो द बीम एज इट पासिस थ्रू दिस कैविटी इन ईच सर्कुलेशन इट कीप्स गेटिंग एक्सेलरेटेड. Correspondingly, the magnetic field of the magnets keeps on increasing so that every time the particle comes out, its momentum has been increased when it passed through the accelerating cavity. But the magnetic field is adjusted such that with the new momentum and the new magnetic field, radius remains the same. This is according to your rigidity formula. As you can see that there are bending magnets at regular intervals. There are these focusing magnets, which are quadrupole magnets. Bending magnets are dipole. Focusing magnets are quadrupole magnets. They are at regular intervals. And whenever your beam energy, which you desire, has been achieved, there can be an extraction or ejection mechanism by which the beam is sent into a new path and it goes to the experimental facility wherever, or experimental beam hall. Such extraction can be at multiple places, or it can be at a single place. But after going here, there could be another magnet which separates it out into multiple different directions, so that at any given time, you can give the deliver the beam to one of the different targets which are located in the experimental area. ठीक है. This is the basic layout of any accelerator facility. The acceleration mechanism need not be through a ring. It could be a DC accelerator or just a LINAC. The particle need not always be electron. It can be proton or some other ions, depending on what type of source you use. But the idea that there will be regular focusing and bending of the beam as required, that idea remains the same. So these components do not change. When you scale up this accelerator, you have more of these components, that's all. But the actual type of the component does not change. You have basically accelerating cavities, you have bending magnets, focusing magnets. At the initial stage, you will have a source, and you may have either a LINAC or a DC extraction mechanism. And there will be multiple magnets for manipulating the beam in different ways, magnets or electrostatic deflectors. Again, that also depends on the beam energy, etc. But basically, you will have some way of accelerating the particle, you will some way of guiding the particle in different direction, you will some way of focusing the beam. These three things will always be there. And you will have some mechanism to deliver that beam to the experimental working station or experimental area where the actual experiment is being carried out with the beam. ठीक है. So now we will go through a list of different types of sources which can be there. This is not a complete list, but it is quite a lot of things are covered in this. Then we will look at how the bending and focusing mechanisms work, what type of components are used for that. And that will be basically more or less what we want to cover today. ठीक है. So let us start with sources for charged particles. The first type of source, charged particle source, which you can come across is an electron gun. ठीक है. An electron gun produces electrons, obviously. There are several types of electron guns which are available, both commercially and which are made in for specific purpose in laboratories. But the basic idea is the same, that you have some method of producing electrons from a material, and those electrons are then entering into an accelerator and getting accelerated. This particular diagram is not just an electron gun. Electron gun is only this part on the right-hand side, and this is actually an electron LINAC. In fact, those of you who attended the GaN series lecture by Dr. Abhay Deshpande, he was showing this diagram also. This is a 20 MeV electron linac, which is built at Samir, which is located in IIT Bombay campus. And they do this job very nicely. I mean, if you ever get to visit their facility, you can see how they do it. And everything is made almost in-house. It is like a Make in India type of thing. I mean, not because of Make in India, they used to do it anyway. Let us not go into details of all these things. Just focus on the ion, sorry, the electron source. It's an electron gun, which is basically you have a filament, which is heated to a very high temperature, and thermionically it emits electrons. And these thermionic emitted electrons are then accelerated further. So electron gun can be based on thermionic emission. This is the common type, filament based. Of course, the filament, which is of tungsten, is heated, and in front of that, you can, or in contact with that, you can keep a plate which has low work function, so that the when the filament gets heated up, it heats up the plate, and because of the lower work function, very large number of electrons can be emitted from the surface. There are special materials which are built for this. So the filament is not usually a wire filament. The wire filament sits behind a disk, and the disk is the one which emits the radiation. Sorry, emits the electrons. And several methods have been devised for the shape of this particular cathode disk, how it should be, and all these things, such that the electron beam comes out in a with a very fine focused quality, so that you can then easily guide that beam further, rather than a very broad or defocused beam. A nicely focused beam comes out. Then the other type of electron source which you can have, instead of thermionic emission, it relies on photo emission, that is photoelectric emission. These are basically photoelectric type of electron guns, where the laser light is made to fall on the surface, and the surface still has low work function, and it has a particular design so that as soon as the light falls, large number of electrons are ejected, and then those are used for further acceleration, etc. So the mechanism of generating electrons can differ. What could be common is that the work function should be low of the material which you are using for the cathode. Other properties can be there, like some material properties, like it should be able to withstand high amount of heat, etc. All these properties can be there, but the primary requirement is low work function. Much more details about this can be studied and are studied regularly in order to get the most efficient types of electron guns which are possible. And efficiency need not always be in terms of number of particles produced. It is also about how focused the beam can be produced from an electron gun, because that ultimately decide how much of those electrons which are produced can be actually confined and accelerated along the accelerator. So lot of details can be studied about these electron guns and the design of filament, the design of the electrode system. For example, the example shown here is a diode gun which just has anode and cathode. But if you introduce a intermediate grid type electrode called a triode, means the whole system is called a triode, then a triode or tetrode type guns, they have better performance in terms of being able to confine the electron current and so on. So a lot of technologies are there in this sector for generating high energy electrons. But the primary idea is that you have a material from which you eject the electrons by some mechanism, either by heating or by a photoelectric effect or some other mechanism. That is a basic idea about electron gun, which I wanted to discuss over here. Any questions at this stage, or comments, or something else?
So what about this shape that
What about the
shape of this gun, you know?
Shape of the gun? I mean, you mean this this part?
Yes, sir.
That is not the gun. The gun is here. The filament would be somewhere at the center, and the anode would be here. And you apply a filament voltage to heat up the filament from here, and basically a high negative voltage so that the electron will get repelled and attracted towards this. This is just a cable for taking the. I think this is for. I am not sure, but I think this is for providing the power supply to the filament. So this design is not crucial at all. You can directly have this object kept here also, is what is my understanding. However, I am not the one who designed this. They may have a specific purpose for this. They also make a lot of ready-made consumer type of integrated electron gun systems. So maybe it is part of their design related to that, in the sense this may be convenient when you are assembling it at a commercial level. Probably maybe this maybe you house the whole thing in a some kind of container and only this pin is seen from out or something. That may be the reason for this particular design. I am not sure actually, but the electron gun itself is here. It has to be on axis and as close to the accelerator as possible. You cannot have electrons, for example, produced here and then how will you bend them from here to here? Not possible. So electrons are produced here somewhere and extracted in this direction. This is the anode and cathode would be somewhere here. This is an insulation so that high voltage can be provided to cathode from here. This is a ceramic material. So this and this are isolated. This is at high negative voltage and this is at ground voltage. The filament will be suspended from here so that it is not in contact with any of these things which are all at ground potential. Is that okay?
Yes, sir. So I think it's the power supply. It has that hole for single cable supply, right?
Yeah, it's a power supply for the filament. And it would be electrically, again it will be isolated because the filament would be floating at the cathode power supply value. Okay. But the electron gun itself, the electron cathode would be here, the disc would be here somewhere. Yes, it would be on axis anyway. Electrons are difficult enough to guide without any trouble. You can't have them produced off-site and brought into the gun somewhere. Okay. Is that okay?
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Yeah. Moving on, this was about electron source. Electron gun is usually the source indicated for electrons. When you come to ions, there are several more varieties of sources. In particular, we will focus first on a source of negative ions. This source is called the SNICS source. SNICS stands for source of negative ions by cesium sputtering. You can see the short form SNICS. Okay. So this name is also complicated looking and the source is also complicated. So I would like you to pay attention over here. Okay. First, let me talk about why you need a negative ion source. There may be some experiments where you are interested in the properties of negative ions, because negative ions are commonly formed in several situations in space plasmas, etc. Along with positive ions and neutrals, you also have some fraction of negative ions. So there is a fundamental interest in studying the properties of negative ions. Negative ions give a good test for quantum mechanics also, in many ways. So that is another fundamental reason. But by far, I think the main reason why you have a negative ion source usually in an accelerator setting is that you are trying to operate a tandem ion accelerator. We have seen earlier about tandem accelerators. A tandem accelerator is basically either a Van de Graaff or Cockcroft-Walton or some similar type of machine, where the terminal voltage is taken, or the what you call the dome voltage, or the main positive what you say region of positive potential that is taken to as high the potential as possible using those mechanisms, either Van de Graaff or Cockcroft-Walton or some other. But then what is done is you take a ion source which produces negative ions and keep it at ground potential. Immediately the negative ions will get attracted towards the terminal because terminal is positively charged, the ion is negative. Barabar hai. Once it reaches the terminal, you have some mechanism of stripping this ion because it is already moving at very large kinetic energy. Reason being that it got accelerated from ground potential up to the terminal potential. So when it arrives at that point, it is passed through a thin foil of carbon or some other material, or it is passed through a channel of gas, maybe argon gas or something, inert gas, such that as it passes through that region, it gradually gets stripped off of the electrons so that what entered that region as a negative ion actually comes out as a positive ion. And once that happens, it again accelerates away from the terminal towards the ground potential so that in such a tandem accelerator, you get double advantage. You accelerate the ion towards the terminal and then again additionally away from the terminal. So total energy gained is double or more than double if the charge of the ion is different. This we have discussed already, so I just described it again in brief, the working of a tandem accelerator. However, the key to operating such a tandem accelerator is that you need a source of negative ions because the starting point itself is that I have a negative ion and it will get accelerated towards the terminal. There comes the role of the Snicks source in accelerators. The basic idea of a Snicks source, as the name suggests, it produces negative ions by sputtering out the material using cesium. Why cesium? Because cesium is a highly electro positive metal. It is the highest electropositivity other than francium, but francium is radioactive. So cesium is the best choice. And it is also a very heavy atom, very high Z. So it can easily sputter out any material. I hope you are familiar with the word sputtering or the concept of sputtering. Have you come across this sometime? Hello?
No.
No. Anyone else? So everyone else has heard about sputtering.
No.
No. Okay, sputtering is basically a mechanism where you bombard a material with a very high Z ion with decent amount of energy. And what happens is that when this heavy ion is bombarding on that surface, it will dislodge some of the particles and those particles will come out. This is a basic concept of sputtering. For a physical example, imagine you have a full swimming pool filled with table tennis ball. Table tennis ka ball dekha hai na, plastic ka, ping pong ball.
Yes,
Hello.
sir.
Haan. So you have a whole swimming pool filled with that. Suddenly one day you walk in with a big football, and with all your football or basketball, volleyball, whatever. You with full force, you throw that basketball on the ping pong balls ka swimming pool. What will happen?
So the ping pong balls will like kind of jumping here and there.
Exactly. They will jump here and there. Some of them may jump quite high. Barabar hai? Now imagine this same process where you have a material made up with lighter atoms. And you throw one heavy atom with very large speed at that. Some of them will then jump out. Barabar hai? This is the basic concept of sputtering mechanism. You take a high Z or high atomic weight means ion, bombard it onto a substrate which contains lighter ions. The lighter heavier part is not that crucial, but it always was sputtering works better when you have a high Z material bombarding on a low Z target. It works better. That's all. Efficiency of sputtering is good. Okay. So when you do this, the atoms in that material will get discharged and some of them gain enough kinetic energy to actually come out. But whenever you are talking about atoms, it is not a single entity. It is composed of nucleus and electrons. So in the process of sputtering, sometimes few of those atoms may get ionized also. But in the particular case of cesium sputtering, cesium being a highly electro positive material, it donates its electron to the sputtered atom, and so the sputtered atom comes out with negative charge because it means on the way out from the material, cesium says mera electron le lo mujhe nahi chahiye type of, so that the other atom is always less electro negative than the electro positivity of cesium, and so always the other atom will accept the electron from cesium. And as you can see in this diagram, you are bombarding this cesium vapor onto this target, and what is coming out is a stream of negative ions. Remaining parts of this diagram, I mean, if you want to know, there is an oven of cesium here, and the cesium vapor comes out like this. And there are two hot plates which are called ionizer plates. Not two, they will be all surrounding in all directions radially. And the, in that hot plate, when the cesium vapor goes and sits, immediately cesium gets vaporized. And as soon as it gets vaporized, there is a not only vaporized, it gets ionized. And the cesium ion gets attracted towards this particular electrode, which is biased at a negative voltage, and so the cesium atoms, cesium ions go and hit over here, and there is an electrode to focus the cesium beam so that whatever is coming from the ionizer, all of this goes and hits dead center on this particular target. I'll repeat this once again. Cesium vapor, there is cesium material inside this oven. Oven is heated, cesium vapor comes out and starts spreading in this whole region. There are two extremely hot plates kept over here, which are called ionizer plates. As soon as the cesium vapor hits the plate, immediately it gets ionized because of the heat. And the ionized cesium immediately gets attracted towards here because this point is negatively biased. Cesium vapor directly won't go there because it is neutral. It is not ionized. Okay. And when the cesium vapor hits the material gets sputtered out. Already, as the time progresses, there will be cesium deposited on the surface layer of this material. So whenever the other material is sputtered out, it passes by a few layers of cesium ions or atoms which are at the surface layer. And while passing through that layer, these sputtered atoms gain a negative charge because they are interacting with cesium, which is highly electropositive. So final bottom line kya hai? Using cesium sputtering, you have obtained negative ions. That is why it is called source of negative ions by cesium sputtering. Is this clear to everyone? The mechanism of the SNCC source?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Any doubts from anyone? Yeah, if not, then let me come to the other two figures which are here, which are photographs. This is a photograph of a multi cathode wheel, which is depicted in this diagram on the left. It is depicted by this particular gray colored object, which is called cathode holder disc. Because suppose in an accelerator, in an accelerator facility, for example, you need different types of ions. Then they prepare samples for, let us say, nitrogen, carbon, silicon, sulfur, A, B, C, whatever other elements you need. Separate targets are prepared. And also, normally there is a redundancy, means first four targets will be filled with some material. which when sputtered by cesium will yield you nitrogen ions, let us say. Next four will be filled with some material which will yield silicon ions. Next four will be filled with something which will yield sulfur ions, etc., etc. So different types of ions can be produced. Negative ions of different elements can be produced from here. Actually, nitrogen doesn't work very well, but we'll not go into that detail. There is another type of negative ion source for some elements which don't work with this next source. But I am not going into that detail. We'll cover it later if we ever need to. Okay. But the basic idea is that you, because all of this whole, whatever is enclosed in this yellow bubble over here, everything will be enclosed in vacuum. Because without vacuum, neither the cesium ions are going to pass unhindered up to the cathode, nor the negative ions which are sputtered are going to come like this straight. Whole region is in vacuum. So obviously, if I want to select a new type of ion, it is not feasible to keep on opening the whole vacuum, because vacuum break kiya to, first of all, you have to wait for the cesium vapor to subside. Cesium is also highly electropositive. Highly reactive metal. And so you cannot just randomly handle cesium. Cesium has to be handled only under a closed atmosphere of either argon or nitrogen, which are inert gases. Inert means nitrogen is chemically inert. It doesn't react with other gases or other materials. Okay. You need an argon chamber or a nitrogen chamber for doing this. You cannot do it in air. Cesium handling cannot be done in air because it will react very violently and explode because it is highly reactive metal. You can search for YouTube videos on the how the cesium reacts. You will find that it's just terrific. You must have done in school na this sodium ka pani mein dalenga to dekha hai na chemistry lab mein sometimes. पानी में डालेगा तो ये सीजियम फुसने करेगा फुट करके फूटेगा बॉम्ब अपना सुतली बॉम्ब जैसा फूटेगा वो सेम अमाउंट ऑफ सीजियम व्हाट दैट छोटा छोटा सोडियम टुकड़ा यू शुड डू इन स्कूल सेम अमाउंट ऑफ सीजियम इफ यू पुट इन ए बीकर ऑफ वाटर होल थिंग विल ब्लो अप इन योर फेस इट इज वेरी वेरी वायलेंटली रिएक्टिव इट्स ऑल्सो टॉक्सिक बिकॉज बींग ए हेवी मेटल बिकॉज ऑफ ऑल दिस रीजन्स opening closing the source is not a trivial thing. Okay. And because of this reason, normally it is advisable to have a multiple target setup such that you can load all of this and keep so that within the vacuum, just this wheel has to be rotated so that in front of the cesium beam, a new source will come instead of the original one. And you can keep on rotating this from outside without breaking the vacuum. This is another diagram of something similar. Where all this is inside a vacuum chamber and basically they actually rotate this by 1-1 unit so that inside the source the cathode gets rotated and from the new cathode whatever is you have loaded in that cathode wo wala beam tumko milega. So this is just a diagram of this kind of ion source. The same type of ion source we have in our AMS, which is there in our campus, okay, accelerator mass spectrometer. That also has a 200 sample holder, multi-cathode disc. Okay. So all these kind of innovations are done so that you can better be able to protect what you are doing. But the basic mechanism of the SNCC source is only this, which is there in the yellow. Okay. Is this okay with everyone? Shall we move further? Or if you have any doubt on this, you can please ask at this stage. Okay, if not, then we will move further. So this was about a source of negative ions. As I mentioned, the primary use of such a source of negative ions is always as a input to a tandem accelerator, and SNCC sources can provide reasonably good currents. It depends on how much is the cathode voltage, or rather how much is the current which is there, which is passing through the ionizer. Because more heated is the ionizer, more cesium ions you will produce, and more you will get the output of the sputtered ions. ठीक है, सो दे कैन प्रोड्यूस एक्सट्रीमली हाई बीम करंट्स इन द रेंज ऑफ एटलीस्ट सेवरल टेन्स ऑफ माइक्रो एम्पियर्स. दिस आई हैव सीन माई सेल्फ एट द TIFR पेलेट्रॉन, बट इवन हायर इज पॉसिबल. मिली एम्पियर्स काइंड ऑफ रेंज इज समटाइम्स पॉसिबल बेस्ड ऑन सम कंडीशन एक्सेट्रा. सो यू कैन गेट हाई करंट एंड ए टैंडम एक्सेलरेटर हैज अ डिसेंट थ्रूपुट फॉर हाई करंट. सो यू विल गेट ए you can get quite a large current even at the output of the tandem. So these are useful for producing maybe somewhere in the range of MeV energy beams if you have a decently high tandem accelerator. TIFR Pellitron produces beams of tens of MeV. I have myself done experiment with silicon beam of 91 MeV, carbon beams of 40, 50, even 60 MeV, oxygen beams up to 60 MeV, all these are possible. Okay. Carbon is 60 is a bit difficult, but it's doable. I mean, it's doable. Okay. So, I mean, these are just some typical numbers for your information. And all of this originates from a SNCC source. TIFR Pellitron has a SNCC source. So just for your information that this can be the kind of beams which you can get. And of course the tandem ka output can then be sent through a LINAC. TIFR also has a LINAC section attached to the tandem, so that after the tandem the LINAC basically roughly doubles the energy. So you can get few hundreds of MeV beam where the original and with currents in the range of 40, 50, 60 nanoamperes. 100 nanoamperes also we have used at Pellitron. So this is possible with this kind of machine. Okay. Moving on to the next type of source. Now we will try to look at three different ways of producing positive ions. Why these three? Because these three are very popularly used. And I will also tell the kind of machines or kind of accelerators where these are most useful. But let me now describe the idea of this particular type of source. Whenever you studied vacuum technology, did you study something called the Penning gauge?
No, sir.
Experimental physics. Experimental physics, vacuum to sikha rahega na, turbo pump and all this.
Yes, sir.
But Penning gauge सीखा था क्या? I am not talking to the ones who opted for numerical technique. वो उनका सिर दर्द है. Why you didn't take experimental physics? I am talking to the ones who took experimental physics. Penning gauge देखा है कभी? ने सुना है?
Yes, sir.
Okay, good. So now the half of the class who didn't have experimental physics can now talk to the other half who did have and take notes on what is Penning gauge. But just to describe to you all briefly. Since anyway we are on that topic, Penning gauge was invented by Penning to measure vacuum, and then someone figured out that I can use the same kind of methodology to produce ions, which is a very interesting concept. So what they do is very interesting. The green color here is some gas which you are inletting from here. This is a cylindrical region. A actual practical example of this is here. ठीक है, a Penning ion gauge. This is gas feed, which is similar to this. A large magnetic field is applied in the downward direction in this diagram. ठीक है, you can see this. The magnetic field is applied in the downward direction, and you apply a a filament power supply. Over here, ठीक है, so that this filament will get heated and by thermionic emission he will emit electrons, ठीक है, and there is also a high voltage which is developed between the chamber and the cathode, ठीक है, so that this whole chamber is at one voltage and the cathode is at a different voltage. The cathode, that is this filament, is at a different voltage. And at the other end, there is another plate which has the same potential as the cathode. Okay. So basically what these people do is that the electrons will get emitted from here. Everyone agrees with this?
Yes, sir.
Electrons, once they enter, because of the magnetic field, they will undergo gyroscopic motion, helical motion. Everyone agrees with this?
Yes, sir.
Now, with whatever energy the means, since this whole chamber is at one voltage and the cathode is at a different voltage, the electron is confined to move spirally. Ideally, the electron will like to go and hit on the wall, but it cannot because of the magnetic field. Magnetic field high enough to confine the electron. Okay. Now, he keeps going down. If you measure the potential from one end to the other of this tube, from top to bottom, the top and bottom are at the same potential because they are connected directly. Okay. This plate is at the same potential as the cathode. Okay, that is why it is called anti-cathode. Means it is like a cathode at the other end, but it is not a real cathode because the real cathode is actually heated and emitting electrons. This guy is just having same potential as the cathode. So somewhere in between, there will be positive potential. This is negative, this is negative, middle is positive. So kya hoenga? Electron jayenga, and as he tries to go further down, he will get decelerated because this also negative, electron also negatively charged. At some stage, that electron will turn around and again start going up, again turn around, again start coming down. When he keeps getting repelled from both the ends, and he can only travel along this line because of the magnetic field. So now look at the electron repelled by this cathode, repelled by this anti-cathode, and confined to move only in this direction because of the magnetic field. So basically, perpetually, the electron will keep moving. Upar niche, upar niche, upar niche, in gyroscopic motion, never ending. Unless he goes and hits on the walls, which happens from time to time, depending on the electron densities and whether he collides with some of the gas molecules or so on. Till now, the story is clear to everyone?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Any doubt from anyone about the story? Okay, if not, but let me still repeat the story once again for everyone's benefit. There is a cathode. There is another plate which is having same potential as the cathode. And in between, this whole chamber is at a different potential, positive with respect to the cathodes. So electron ejected from the cathode will travel downwards because of the magnetic field in gyroscopic motion, gol gol, spring jaisa, like it is shown in this diagram, more or less. And he will not be allowed to reach up to the bottom because before reaching the bottom, he'll get repelled by this anti-cathode and again start moving upwards. Before he reaches this cathode, again get repelled downward. Aisa wo means like this Trishanku. There is one story in Ramayana somewhere that there was this king who wanted to go to heaven, but he wanted to go with his actual physical body. He does not want to die. So then some rishi sends him with body to heaven. So heaven mein bolta hai, idhar body wala allowed nahi hai. And then he tries to come back to earth. Earth mein bolta hai, idhar dead wala allowed nahi hai. So he gets stuck. Upar jayenga to because he has body, he is not allowed. Niche jayenga to because he is dead, he is not allowed. So like that, this electron also like Trishanku, it keeps on going oscillating from here to here. In the process, what will happen is very interesting. Electron, of course, had an initial energy because of being ejected from the cathode. Okay. And with that energy, that electron is moving up and down, and he collides with some of the gas molecules which you are putting in. This is the main part of the story. As soon as the electron collides with the atom, what happens? The atom will get ionized. Okay. So in this gas region, there will be some ionized atoms, and those ions are attracted by a high voltage which is placed here at an extraction voltage, which would be somewhere the extractor would be somewhere outside this, I suppose, outside this opening. And from there, the beam gets extracted. So all positive ions which are produced in this region come out from here. And then that is further accelerated by whatever mechanism you have. So this is the basic idea of a PIG ion source, Penning ion gauge type ion source. Okay. or pig iron source also it is called, pig is. So basic working of the pig is like this. The electron lifetime inside this region is extended by a several orders of magnitude, because the electron which was supposed to go and end up here actually keeps moving between these two because of the magnetic field lines. And in the process of wandering from here to here, here to here, it keeps colliding with gas molecules, and those gas molecules get ionized, and those ions are attracted outside by this high voltage plate, which is the extractor plate. Is this okay? Everyone is clear on how the ion is produced?
Yes, sir.
Now, बोलो नहीं ये से बोला ना या ओके आई एम मूविंग ऑन या ओके गुड आई एम मूविंग ऑन यू कैन इमेजिन दैट इन दिस प्रोसेस बिकॉज दिस इज नॉट अ वेरी वायलेंट और वेरी रिपीटेटिव प्रोसेस मीन्स व्हाट इज द चांसेस दैट एक एटम गैस एटम ग्रीन कलर वाला उसको एक इलेक्ट्रॉन टकराया और थोड़ी देर के अंदर और एक इलेक्ट्रॉन टकराया फिर तीसरा इलेक्ट्रॉन द प्रोबेबिलिटी ऑफ दिस इज वेरी वेरी स्मॉल मोस्ट लाइकली वन इलेक्ट्रॉन टकराया वो पॉजिटिव आयन बन गया इधर से एक्सट्रैक्ट हो गया चला गया सो द पिग आयन सोर्स नॉर्मली इज केपेबल ऑफ प्रोड्यूसिंग डिसेंट करंट्स माइक्रो एम्पियर्स और सो बट ओनली सिंगल चार्ज और मैक्सिमम डबल चार्ज नॉट मोर देन दैट मीन्स सपोज आई हैव नाइट्रोजन गैस देन आई विल गेट नाइट्रोजन 1+ or best case scenario I'll get nitrogen 2+. This depends to some extent on the work function of the gas. So helium having very high work function, or not work function, what is it called, ionization potential. So helium having very high ionization potential, helium is most difficult to ionize. Other gases, depending on their ionization potential, you will get different amount of yield. It is not necessary that ek गैस का इतना करंट मिला तो दूसरे का भी उतना ही मिलेगा देयर इज अनदर एस्पेक्ट टू द होल थिंग दैट ऑल द आयंस व्हिच आर प्रोड्यूस्ड डोंट कम आउट सम ऑफ देम विल रिकंबाइन मीनिंग दैट दे विल फ्लोट अराउंड एज आयंस टिल दे मीट अनदर इलेक्ट्रॉन दे विल कंबाइन टुगेदर एंड अगेन बिकम ए न्यूट्रल एटम ठीक है रिकॉम्बिनेशन इज ऑल्सो ए इंपॉर्टेंट मैकेनिज्म इन आयन सोर्सेस सो विथ ऑल दिस टेकन इन टू अकाउंट यू विल फाइंड दैट this source is not extremely efficient, and best it can do for you is deliver either single charge or double charge, not more than that. Okay? Why the charge state is important? Because you know that the electric force is Q into E. So for the same electric field, if the charge is double, I will get double the amount of force, or the energy will be Q into V. So if for the same potential or the same voltage, if I have double charge, I will get double energy. If I have triple charge, I will get triple energy. So definitely, if you want to accelerate ions to large energies, higher charge states are definitely desirable. Okay? It would be very nice to have higher charge state. However, the pig ion source is a source which cannot produce more than either 1+ or 2+ of any ion. Means let us say helium 1+, helium 2+, or oxygen 1+, and 2+ will be significantly less in yield than 1+. So if you get a microampere current of 1+, maybe 2+ will be in tens of nanoamperes or something, much less. Because see, for getting a 2+ ion, you need the electrons to hit that ion twice before he gets extracted. That is not a simple thing, okay? Or the probability of that is very less. Okay, so this is basic idea about pig ion source. Pig ion source is extremely popular where low charge kind of applications are sufficient. Classic example is ion implantation, etc. So pig ion sources are very popular sources in ion implanters, because especially near surface, that is thin film ion implantation, you don't need high charge state, you don't need high energy. So a pig ion source with a decent few hundred kV kind of acceleration is sufficient. So that can be a tabletop type machine where day in day out you keep depositing ions of a particular type for modifying the material properties. For example, if you want a thin film which is to be doped by some other element, these things can be easily achieved in a ion implanter with a pig ion source, with extremely reasonable results. ठीक है, is that okay? Any other questions on this pig iron source? नहीं है, ठीक है.
मेनिन टाइप के गैसियस एटम्स. हेलो
हाँ बोलिए.
सर मैं इट मींस दैट द इलेक्ट्रॉन्स आर पॉजिटिव वंस दैट आर मींस एमिटेड फ्रॉम दैट कैथोड दे
नहीं नहीं
स्ट्राइक
क्या
विद
क्या
द
क्या क्या
एटम.
क्या 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 क्या
नहीं मींस वहां से जो इलेक्ट्रॉन्स है अपने इलेक्ट्रॉन्स निकल रहे वो कैथोड रेस वो
हाँ
हीटिंग के बाद से फिलामेंट से
हाँ
तो वो उसमें प्रेजेंट गैसियस पार्टिकल मींस गैसियस एटम के साथ टकराते हैं तो उससे आयन बनता है ना.
बराबर. जो ग्रीन कलर का जो गैस आप इनलेट कर रहे हो ना उससे
हाँ
टकराते हैं. हाँ हाँ हाँ
मींस वो उसके अंदर जो गैसियस पार्टिकल है उससे टकरा के आयंस बन रहा है.
हाँ जी हाँ जी हाँ जी हाँ
ओके ओके ठीक है भाई.
आपका डाउट क्या था मैं समझा नहीं.
नहीं मुझे ये डाउट था कि वो गैसेस मींस वो आयन कौन से चीज के थे मींस उसके
गैसियस
अंदर
को गैस
ऑलरेडी.
आप इनपुट
हाँ
कर रहे हो उसके.
हाँ
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 तो
वही बात.
ये अच्छा पॉइंट है कि यू कैन नॉट प्रोड्यूस आयन्स ऑफ मेटल्स एटसेट्रा यूजिंग ए पिग आयन सोर्स. नॉर्मली मींस यू हैव टू मॉडिफाई दिस समहाउ इफ यू वांट टू डू दैट. नॉर्मली गैसियस तो नॉर्मली आर्गन होता है. आर्गन इज वेरी पॉपुलर बिकॉज आर्गन इज द चीपेस्ट गैस, इज द मोस्ट अबंडेंट इन एटमोसफेयर आफ्टर नाइट्रोजन एंड ऑक्सीजन, यू नो दैट. सो आर्गन इज क्वाइट पॉपुलर बट मेनली फॉर गैसेस. यस दैट्स राइट. यू कैन डू मेटल आयन्स विथ ए स्पेशल टेक्निक. यू कैन फाइंड आउट ए गैस विच कंटेन्स दैट मेटल. गैस और ए लिक्विड विच कैन अंडरगो सब्लिमेशन टू फॉर्म ए गैस बिकॉज दिस ऑल दिस इज अंडर वैक्यूम कंडीशन. देर कैन बी सम लो व्हाट यू से व्हाट इज कॉल्ड हाई वेपर प्रेशर. माने इफ यू क्रिएट वैक्यूम दैट थिंग विल स्टार्ट इवेपरेटिंग नेचुरली. वन काइंड ऑफ सच एग्जाम्पल इज ए गैस कॉल्ड फेरोसिन. फेरोसिन इज बेसिकली ए कॉम्प्लिकेटेड ऑर्गेनिक कंपाउंड कंटेनिंग आयरन एंड वेन एवर यू पुट इट इन साइड अ वैक्यूम इट विल स्टार्ट सब्लिमेटिंग इन टू अ गैशियस स्टेट. सो दैट कैन बी दैट काइंड ऑफ फेरोसिन गैस कैन बी इंट्रोड्यूस्ड इन टू दिस आयन सोर्स एंड यू विल गेट सम यील्ड ऑफ आयरन बट आई एम नॉट श्योर हाउ वेल इट दैट विल वर्कआउट. आई डोंट नो वेदर इट हैज बीन ट्राइड और समथिंग बट फॉर मेटल्स देर आर वर्क अराउंड. यू कैन ट्राई सम थिंग्स. ठीक है, इज दैट ओके? हेलो
यस सर यस.
या ओके. सो लेट अस मूव फर्दर टू द नेक्स्ट टाइप ऑफ आयन सोर्स. दिस इज अनदर टाइप, कंप्लीटली डिफरेंट टाइप कॉल्ड इलेक्ट्रॉन साइक्लोट्रॉन रेजोनेंस आयन सोर्स. ठीक है, और ईसीआर आयन सोर्स और इक्रिस, शॉर्ट फॉर्म दे कॉल इक्रिस. द मैकेनिज्म फॉर दिस आयन सोर्स इज शोन इन द पैनल इन द लेफ्ट. बेसिकली इट कंसिस्ट ऑफ टू सेट्स ऑफ मैग्नेटिक फील्ड्स. ग्रीन बार्स विच आर हियर दे आर ऑल्टरनेटिवली नॉर्थ साउथ. सो नॉर्थ साउथ एटसेट्रा. दिख रहा है ना ग्रीन कलर बार्स? सो दिस गिव्स यू ए रेडियल मैग्नेटिक फील्ड बिकॉज इन द हाँ दिख रहा है ना?
यस सर दिख रहे हैं.
हाँ हाँ सो सो दिस हाँ दिस गिव्स यू ए रेडियल मैग्नेटिक फील्ड विच विल हेल्प टू कन्फाइन द गैस. आई विल एक्सप्लेन हाउ बट बेसिकली देर इज ए रेडियल मैग्नेटिक फील्ड एंड देर आर टू कॉइल्स हियर विच आर कैरिंग करंट इन द राउंड डायरेक्शन एंड दे विल प्रोड्यूस ए मैग्नेटिक फील्ड इन द एक्सियल डायरेक्शन. सो यू गॉट एन एक्सियल एंड ए रेडियल मैग्नेटिक फील्ड. नाउ व्हाई यू नीड ऑल दिस इज बिकॉज द मैकेनिज्म ऑफ दिस सोर्स इज लाइक दिस. यू इनपुट द गैस विच इज शोन हियर इन ए ब्लू कलर एरो एंड साइमल्टेनियसली यू इनपुट माइक्रोवेव रेडिएशन ऑल्सो थ्रू ए वेव गाइड. ठीक है, इफ यू वॉन्ट टू सी ए प्रैक्टिकल एग्जाम्पल ऑफ ए वेव गाइड यू कैन सी दिस ब्लैक ऑब्जेक्ट इन द फोटोग्राफ. यू कैन सी दिस ब्लैक ऑब्जेक्ट हियर विच इज कमिंग फ्रॉम हियर लाइक ए पाइप, यू नो इज गोइंग लाइक दिस देन बेंडिंग डाउनवर्ड्स एंड देन कंटिन्यूइंग हियर. आर एबल टू सी दैट? आर यू एबल टू सी माई पॉइंटर रादर देन?
यस सर
या
यस सर.
इट इज ए वेव गाइड टिपिकली लाइक टिपिकली हाफ एन इंच और सो इन डायमेंशन. That depends on the microwave frequency which you are using, but this is probably for either 14.5 gigahertz or 18 gigahertz. then this kind of size of waveguide is convenient for that. Because you know the waveguide dimension depends on the frequency of the electromagnetic wave which it is guiding. So this is the waveguide, and using the waveguide, the microwave is also injected. Now the interesting thing which happens is the following. You know that whenever a gas is there at room temperature, it will contain at least a few electrons always, because any neutral gas always is in a dynamic equilibrium of ionization recombination, very, very small fraction, like 1 in 10 power 5 or 1 in 10 power 6 will be thermally always getting ionized. Okay. Now, those electrons which are already present over there, they will gain energy from the microwave radiation. How they manage to gain energy? Because in a given magnetic field which is set up by these radial magnets and these two axial magnets, in a given value of magnetic field, the electron has a natural gyroscopic frequency called the cyclotron frequency. The cyclotron frequency is given by omega is equal to qb by m, where q is the charge, b is the magnetic field, and m is the mass. So q by m is fixed for electron, e by m, and b is whatever you have applied the magnetic field. If that b is chosen in a particular way, then you can, if you input the microwaves of that frequency, omega equal to eb by m, those electrons will suddenly gain large amount of energy by absorbing it from the microwave. This diagram probably explains it a little better. The microwave wave is basically a kind of, because it is passing through a waveguide, etc., it is polarized in a particular way. And this microwave transfers this energy to the electrons. Basically, the microwave electric field is oscillating like this. If the electron's natural frequency also matches with this, then the electron gains a lot of energy. That is the story. Okay. Or if you want to keep the story simple, then basically what I said, that the electron has a natural frequency where it can absorb large amounts of energy, resonant frequency, depending on the magnetic field. So for a particular value of magnetic field and particular value of microwave radiation, it will absorb that huge amount of energy. Barabar hai. And when it absorbs this huge amount of energy, what will the electron do? The electron is still confined by the magnetic field, same like a pig iron source. There is an axial magnetic field, so he will go aga pacha, go back and forth, not going to escape from here. And also he cannot go radially outwards, because radially also there is a confinement. So the electron is confined within this blue-shaped region, more or less. Okay? And whenever he crosses the surface of this blue-shaped region, his cyclotron frequency matches with the microwave frequency, and he gains energy. So that very soon you have few electrons which are having extremely high energy. Whenever they collide with the gas molecules which are coming in, they will ionize the gas. The new electrons which are produced again gain energy by the cyclotron process. They will in turn ionize more gas, and very soon you have a very hot plasma containing lots of electrons and lots of ions. Was the mechanism what I described clear to you, everyone? Is there any doubt on this?
Bolo.
Okay. So again, let me repeat. Whenever electrons are placed in a magnetic field, depending on the value of magnetic field, there is always a resonant frequency where they can absorb large amounts of energy, because the oscillation pattern of the electric field will match with the gyroscopic motion of the electron. Matlab electron jis frequency se wo rotate kar raha hai around the magnetic field, that frequency will be same as the frequency of the electromagnetic wave. So har chakkar mein wo jab round maar ke aayega, tab wo energy gain karega. This part is clear to everyone? It is okay? What is meant by resonant?
Yes, sir.
yeah. And for that imagination, I said that in the right hand side diagram, this microwave is shown as a gyroscopic motion. That is nothing but a polarized wave. Okay. Any elliptically polarized wave will, the electric field vector will trace out this particular kind of path, helical path. So, and that will match with the electron's helical path. Therefore, the electron suddenly gains huge amount of energy. This part is clear to everyone? Yes. Means, are you convinced that microwave radiation, I say thrown into thin air, can give energy to the electron when that electron's magnetic field value is matching? Means when omega is equal to EV by M. This part is okay with everyone?
Yes.
This concept is called electron cyclotron resonance. Electron, because the particle is an electron. Cyclotron resonance is the name for that particular type of resonant energy transfer from the electromagnetic wave to the charged particle. Okay. So this phenomena is called electron cyclotron resonance. Now what you are doing is you are taking advantage of this. First of all, you have applied magnetic field in two directions, both radial magnetic field using the green color magnets and axial magnetic field using the red color coils. Okay. So you have, and that is seen in this diagram also. There is a radial magnetic field with alternative north south. Dikh raha idhar? These magnets. Some are pointing arrow outward, some are pointing arrow inwards. Dikh raha kya?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. So alternate ones are having north south, etc. Okay. So you can see that in the radial direction also there is a magnetic field, and along the axis also there is a magnetic field. So the electron cannot go arbitrarily anywhere. He is confined within that region. And my claim is that electrons are confined within the blue odd shaped region, which is shown over here in this diagram. Okay. This patch which is shown, my claim is that electrons are confined in this region by the different magnetic fields which have been applied. And whenever the electrons cross the surface of this region, at the boundary of this region, the value of magnetic field is such that the microwave condition omega equal to EB by M is satisfied. Okay. So whenever the electron crosses the surface, he gains energy, goes back inside. If there is any gas which is there inside, he collides with them, ionizes them. New electrons are produced. New electrons ka bhi wahi funda hai. Whenever they cross this surface, they will gain large amount of energy. So very soon, the electrons gain a large amount of energy. For simple example, imagine something like this. Okay. Suppose your friends take you. They say, come with us. So you go with your friends. Then suddenly they take you into a dark room. They push you inside. All lights are off, everything. They put one kambal or a blanket on top of you. And sab log dhap 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 maarta hai tumko. Theek hai? Toh tumhara kya halat hoega? Imagine karo. What will happen? What you will feel or what you will experience? Same kind of thing is experienced by the gas molecule when it enters this region. Because there are so many energetic electrons all around. Or imagine even simpler example. Suppose someone who is new to Bombay, he tries to travel by train during peak hour. Not now in pandemic condition, in our normal Bombay condition. Then uska kya halat hoega? Means suppose they try to catch the train at Kurla station for means some Panvel train or some Kalyan train from Kurla station at let us say 6 p.m. Many of you must have experienced this. Barabar hai? तो जो हालत होता है ना वो हालत तुम्हारे गैस मॉलिक्यूल का इधर होता है बिकॉज इलेक्ट्रॉन्स आर हाईली एनर्जेटिक हाउएवर द मैग्नेटिक फील्ड वैल्यू इज हाई इनफ दैट दोज इलेक्ट्रॉन्स आर आल्सो कन्फाइंड इन दैट रीजन सो यू हैव गॉट हाईली एनर्जेटिक इलेक्ट्रॉन्स कन्फाइंड इन अ वेरी स्मॉल स्पेस एंड यू आर पुशिंग अ गैस मॉलिक्यूल देयर इमेजिन व्हाट विल हैपन टू द गैस मॉलिक्यूल ये एग्जाम्पल इज क्लियर टू एवरी वन वॉट टाइप ऑफ इमेजिनेशन यू नीड टू अंडरस्टैंड दिस ठीक है, इज इट ओके?
यस सर।
यस सर।
सो इमेजिन दैट दिस गैस मॉलिक्यूल एंटर्स इनटू दिस ब्लू पैच देर आर ऑलरेडी लार्ज नंबर ऑफ एनर्जेटिक इलेक्ट्रॉन्स देर दे विल क्विकली कोलाइड इधर से मारा उधर से मारा एंड वेरी सून that gas molecule loses several electrons, not just one or two. Okay, because the electrons are highly energetic. Even a single collision can lead to more than one electron getting knocked out from the atom. Okay, highly energetic electrons. The typical energies of the electrons in an electron cyclotron ion source is, these are measured values. I have myself measured this in the lab. It was a 14.5 gigahertz ion source. That is the operating frequency of the microwave. And the typical energies are in tens of keV, 70 keV, 80 keV. And some of the particles are going even to the extent of 500, 600, 700 keV. Okay? This is the kind of energy which the electrons gain by repeatedly going through this magnetic field in this presence of the microwave. Okay? It absorbs this energy from the microwave. When I say highly energetic, means really highly energetic. 700, 800 keV electrons. These electrons are still confined because the magnetic field values are in the range of Teslas. Means 0.5 Tesla, 1 Tesla, that type. And some of the bigger sources, they can go up to 2 Tesla, 3 Tesla, 4 Tesla, and so on. Which can have larger capacity or operate at a higher frequency. Okay. These are just to give you an idea of few numbers, that what is the typical energy of electrons in a electron cyclotron resonance ion source, what are the typical magnetic field values used. I'll tell you some stories about this today, before we finish, but basic idea is that extremely high magnetic field, extremely energetic electrons. You can imagine if there are keV energy or tens of keV energy electrons, average energy is around 70 keV, 60 keV types. The electron temperature comes out to be that range. Okay? Means KT, average value of KT. So huge temperature. And so these energetic electrons, any ion which enters or any atom which enters, gas atom which enters that region, you can imagine that immediately it will go into many times it will get ionized suddenly. So you get highly charged ions coming out from the ion source, and the energy of these ions can be as low as energy depends on what is the extraction voltage you apply at this end. That is the red arrow which is shown. Suppose I supply a 30 kilovolt supply, then basically I will get these ions coming out with an energy of 30 kilovolt. Even though the electron temperatures are at several tens of keV, the collision time between electron and ion is very, very long. Okay? And so before the ions actually thermalize with the electron, that is the ions have to collide multiple times till they achieve the same average energy. Before that happens, you are extracting the electron. So basically, even though the electron temperature is very, very hot, the ion temperature, that is the average energy of ions which are produced, is relatively low. Or you say the statement usually given is that the electron cyclotron resonance ion source has a plasma which consists of hot electrons and cold ions. Before the ions also gain the temperature of the electrons by repeatedly colliding with them, you are extracting them out and using them for further experiment. The photograph shows a very small source. I think this is, I do not remember where this is exactly. I think it is SINP, but I am not sure. Basically, there is a microwave input from the waveguide, as I said. There is a gas line which gives a this orange color thing which is coming is the gas line probably. Gas is also injected into this source. This is the solenoid coil which gives the axial magnetic field. There will be some permanent magnet or something for the radial magnetic field as well. And after that, this is a ceramic piece here. So that this is at ground voltage and this is at negative voltage, so that you can extract the ions from here to here. And the ions after extraction, they can be sent through, this is, I suppose, an electrostatic deflector, which sends the beam in a different direction. And then it is carried to wherever the experiments are being done and so on. So a lot of things can be done, but basically any ECR ion source will have some way of generating an axial and radial magnetic field, a microwave waveguide, a gas line for carrying the gas, a vacuum pump which is not seen but somewhere here, and a ceramic kind of arrangement for isolating the source from the next stage so that the extraction can take place from here to here. And this stage will be either a magnet or electrostatic deflector or something which will deflect the beam for further use. Or I think this is just a plain lens type of thing and the beam goes further like this and then there is a deflector. From the diagram it looks that way. Okay. So this is a basic idea of how a electron cyclotron resonance ion source looks. Is this okay? Any questions, doubts, comments on this? Anyway, I would suggest that you should read up about this because I have just touched the fringe of the topic and you can read up much more about this type of source. Is that okay?
Yes, sir. So how do you extract the ion beam then?
You bias the whole ion source at a negative voltage. So that the positive voltage, so that then the positive ions get repelled from there and come out.
But sir, the magnetic field will try to confine the ion source as well, right?
No, because the magnetic field is not sufficient to confine these ions, because the gyro radius etc. will be very different for the ions, and also the amount of field needed for confinement would be different. Okay. Can calculate this. Good question, but you can calculate this. Typical magnetic field values are in the range of Tesla. So you can take a magnetic bottle kind of arrangement with one Tesla field at both the ends, maybe half a Tesla in the middle, and you can check whether this is enough to confine the ions. And anyway, any plasma confinement method always has a loss cone angle, so called. So any ions which are fitting within the loss cone will anyway get extracted. And many times the extraction electrode is actually inserted fairly almost very close to the plasma. So actually the extraction electrode is a cone type electrode which comes almost right up to the tip of the plasma region. Okay. So that it actually extracts the ions specifically from that plasma itself. Okay. The extractor is not kept at this distance. So from inside the ceramic, a cone will be going like this till the plasma. So that means anything which is even nearby that electrode will get attracted and come out. And anyway, the electrons will get repelled from there also because of the opposite polarity.
Okay, so the ions will spend very small time inside the plasma.
Ions anyway spend a small time because there is also another factor which I didn't mention, rather I mentioned it during the pig ion source discussion. Recombination rates are also high. So recombinations also take place. So actually the ions will never thermalize with the electrons because if they are not extracted, then they will recombine. And then a fresh ion which is produced, uska lifetime udhar se shuru hota hai. So basically the recombination times are also smaller than the thermal equilibrium times between electrons and ions. So virtually you never get a situation where the ions in the source get heated up. Electron cyclotron ion sources are not very well understood theoretically. I mean, it just works. Someone had an idea, they made it, they created it. It works to give you great currents. I didn't talk about that, but an electron cyclotron resonance ion source easily gives you milliampere currents of most beams without trouble. And definitely microampere.
Hello?
Yes.
Hello? Sir, for the extraction, we will bias the cavity with the positive ion, so the positive voltage, so the positive ion get repelled. But the electron, the plasma also contain the high temperature electron. Does it get affected by such a positive bias voltage?
The positive bias is applied outside the source to the source chamber. So the electrons are confined inside, so they just they don't experience any potential difference inside the plasma chamber. They don't experience any potential difference. The potential difference is only experienced when you come close to the extraction electrode. Okay. So
okay.
The electrons are not affected as such. Okay. Any other questions? I would again suggest, please read up about this, because I am sure that the explanation, however much, even if I talk for another hour, it will be insufficient explanation unless you read. Some of these things need time to settle in. Okay. So I would suggest that you read up about this. There are enough sources even on internet, but CERN Accelerator School notes have some sections dedicated to this. You can try to search through that. Is that okay? Shall we move further? Yes. Okay, I am moving further. The next concept or next type of ion source which I want to discuss is something called an electron beam ion source, also often called an electron beam ion trap. If you use it as a trap, then it's a trap. If you relax the potential from one side, it becomes an ion source. Okay. The basic idea of a electron beam ion trap or electron beam ion source is very interesting. As the name suggests, it is an ion source which relies only on an electron beam, which is a very interesting concept. If you look at the diagram or the figure, you can see that there is a cathode which is generating an extremely intense electron beam. The intensity of the electron beam is something tremendous. It will be sometimes carrying ampere current. Imagine an ampere current without a wire, just because of electrons being ejected. It's an achievement in itself. Okay. But you have an electron beam which is coming from a cathode, and there is a very, very strong magnetic field using some magnets, which you can see the magnetic field lines are highly focused near the center, and they roll out as you come to the outside the range of the magnets. Dikh raha hai na sabko ye magnetic field lines, thoda barik hai, but I hope you are able to see them. These arrows visible hai?
Yes, sir.
So they are running from here to here and similarly here, and you can see that the magnetic field is extremely high at the center. Correspondingly, because the magnetic field lines are converging and then diverging, the electron beam is confined to gyre it along the magnetic field lines. So electron beam intensity near the center is extremely high. I hope you can see that very clearly. The green ribbon is very, very narrow here, and then again expands, and then there is a collector which will collect the electrons. Okay. So near the center, what is done is you inject some amount of gas near the center. Okay, another thing, there are three electrodes also here, two positive electrode and one negative electrode. These are all cylindrical electrodes. Only half of it is shown, but actually these are three cylinders, left cylinder, right cylinder, center cylinder, and electron passes actually through all the three. It passes along the axis of the three cylinders. Middle cylinder is negative biased, and left and right cylinder are positively biased. Okay. Now, when the electron beam travels through here and a gas is injected, what happens? What is the first thing which will happen when the electron beam, which is of extremely high energy, when it hits the ion, hits the atoms, what will happen?
Ionization.
It will get ionized. Very good. Now, let us try to see what happens to these ionized ions. Once they are ionized, what is the charge of the ion?
Positive
charge. Okay. And you have large column of electrons which are continuously moving. What is the charge of the electrons?
Negative.
So now, what will happen to the ion when he sees this large column of electrons continuously moving in front of him?
So they will get attracted and move along with them?
No, they will not move along, because as soon as he gets attracted, पीछे से आने वाला electron उसको वापस से मारेगा. So he'll get again ionized and thrown out of the way. But now his charge is now double. What will happen now? He gets attracted even more strongly towards the electrons. ठीक है? Once again the electrons will hit. See, electron beam is moving at extremely high velocities because the electron, typically the electron beam energy in a EBIS or EBIT is typically tens of kV, means 40, 50, 60 kV, 100 kV, that kind of range. Okay. So you have got a hugely energetic electron beam traveling down this diagram from left to right. And you have got an ion which just happened to be in the path. Imagine a train which is passing through a particular place. Okay. One guy gets hit by the train. That is your ion. Okay. And he gets thrown somewhere on the side. Now he looks back at the train and he sees that everywhere in every dabba, there are some very beautiful girls or something. Okay. So again, he starts rushing. Mujhe bhi ye train pe chadna hai. He goes in the path of the train. What happens to that guy? He's not moving the same velocity of the train. He just again came in the path of the train. Again gets hit. He's not going to go along because he's not moving at the same speed, nowhere near the same speed. Okay. Is it okay? Example?
Yes, sir.
Again got hit, again further positively charged, with more intensity will try to come again in the path of the electrons. Because now double charge, okay, na, jada attraction. Again gets hit. Now he gets more charge, again he comes. And so this ion keeps doing this, kya bolte na, abail mujhe mar type of thing. He keeps coming in the path of the electron, keeps getting hit, keeps getting ionized. So very soon, this atom is completely ionized, fully stripped. All electrons are gone because wo bar bar mar khate rehta hai na. Is this okay? Ye sabko pat raha hai kya? Is everyone convinced that this can happen?
Yes, sir. And sir, this negative cylinder, it will also keep the ion inside in the middle part, right?
That's right. We'll come to that. We'll come to that. But is everyone convinced that the guy will keep on getting hit by the electron beam and keep on gaining more and more charge? Everyone is okay with this concept? Any doubts on that point?
There should be chance for recombination there, sir. Is there any chance?
There could be some recombination due to the ionized electrons. That is true. But generally, recombination rates will be low because when the electron beam hits with such intensity, there is no confinement of the electrons in this case. It means the secondary electrons which are ejected, they can move freely because the neighboring electrodes are both positive. You can see that, na? So they will get attracted towards those electrodes, if at all. There is nothing to confine the electrons. See, the ions are positively charged. So if you look at the potential energy figure at the bottom, this is the potential energy profile experienced by the ions. There is a positive cylinder here, so that is having positive potential. Another positive here, also positive potential. In between the cylinder where the gas is input is negative potential. So the ions can get confined here. You can see this potential energy diagram at the bottom. Hello?
Yes, sir.
So ions are confined. For electrons, this potential energy diagram is exactly ulta. There will be a peak here and two valleys here. W shape. This is ulta W, na? M shape, na? For electrons, it will be W shape. So electrons, secondary electrons, I'm talking. Primary electrons are already there in the beam and they go here. Usko beech mein matlab. Secondary electrons after ionization will go either this side and get lost. So recombination chances are also low because there is nothing to recombine with. The ions are separately confined here. Usse jo electron chhina gaya, wo bhag jata hai dono taraf se. Is that okay?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So, good question though. That recombination, which was a problem with both ECR and pig ion source, here it is not such a great problem. There will be recombination always, but it is much less intense or much less probable because the electrons are free to escape, whereas ions are confined. And radially also the ions are confined because the electron beam, which is highly negative, is at the center. So most of the ions will gather around the center and around the middle of this electrode. Okay. So because of that, the ions are confined and very soon they can get fully ionized. However, the amount of current which you can generate with this kind of source is relatively lower, because the amount of gas you can inject over here is limited, because then it should not interfere with the overall electron beam traveling through. Rather, it should not disrupt the field due to the electron beam. So bulk of the electrons have to travel straight through. Only then the radial confinement works. Okay. So there are limitations on the kind of currents you can get. Limitation means not severe limitation. You can still get microamperes type of currents or several hundred nanoamperes and all. But less than ECR ion source. However, you have much better control over the kind of charge states, etc., which you can get. For example, if you have a high charge state whose ionization potential you know, you can always make the electron beam energy slightly lower than that. Then you will never get that charge state. You can get only up to below that. And if you keep on increasing the electron beam energy, you can get even fully stripped kind of charge states. So all of this can be achieved using this electron beam ion trap. Electron beam ion source means, so for electron beam ion source, you make the potential of the right cylinder same as this one. Then the confinement is no longer there on the right side. So the ions can escape from here, and that is what they do. They go from here, and the collector field is slightly on the outer side, and an extraction electrode is put in front of it. And so the ions will pass through that. Basically, the collector for electrons has to be positively biased. That will automatically end up as a focusing electrode for the extracted ions, and then there will be a proper extractor and so on. Okay. So you can get an ion beam from here by simply lowering this particular potential, that is by making this cylinder same potential as this. You can achieve the extraction from this particular object. So with this field configuration, it is called an electron beam ion trap. And if you lower the potential on this side, it can act as an electron beam ion source. There are some significant design differences between electron beam ion trap and electron beam ion source, which I will not go into here, but definitely you can read up about this, that for a trap, some of the electrodes are designed slightly differently and the field configurations are slightly different, because your main aim is to be able to trap the ions. For a source, you don't want to trap them, you want to actually extract them. So the electrode configurations, etc., are slightly different. So the same object can be operated in principle as both an electron beam ion trap and an electron beam ion source, but one of the two will suffer in terms of their capabilities. Means either the trap will be not a good trap, or the source will be not as good a source as it could have been. Depends on what you started with. If you start with an electron beam ion trap and try to use it as a source, the performance of your source won't be as good as someone else's source whom they designed it as a source, to be intended to be used as a source. Okay. That is because of some design differences which arise between the two requirements. Requirement of a trap is purely confinement, and requirement of a source is extraction. So they differ in that. That was just additional information. If you didn't understand the last point, you can just leave it out. But anything else about the core ideas about this not understood, please ask. If nothing is there, then you can read up. Okay. That would be anyway a good idea. Is that okay? This is a commercially available kind of electron beam ion source, which is available from a company in Dresden. So they have, that was a university kind of setup where they started, and then now they are producing this commercially. So it's a industry incubated at a university. Very interesting story. You can visit Dresden EBIT or DREBIT. There is a website you can visit and you can have a look at that. Okay, shall we go further? Is it okay?
Yes, sir.
Okay, okay. Read up about this. If there are any doubts, we'll cover it later on. Okay, no problem. Just a few more slides, basically detailing what are the type of ideas where these ion sources or electron sources will be used. So for example, you have a Van de Graaff. the ion source is located inside the terminal, and then there is a extraction from here, and then there is acceleration. So where does the ion source fit within the larger scheme of the accelerator? So an ion source can be here or at the center of a cyclotron, for example. The ion source can be here or at the initial part of a LINAC. The ion source can be here. This is a which type of LINAC is this? Videro type or Alvarez type? Quiz question. Whoever answers first, I'll give prize. When we meet again. Hello.
Sir, it is Alvarez type.
Why do you think so? So good, this is homework for you. Figure out why it is a Videro type or is it Alvarez type and give reasons. Okay, homework for all of you. But basic, my idea here is that there can be different types of accelerators, but the source will always configure somewhere at the center, and then further on it is accelerated using various different mechanisms. So source needs to interface, means in principle a source has to be designed according to the requirement of the further acceleration path, etc., which you are going to take. Is that okay? It's just to identify that concept that the source has to be designed keeping in mind the rest of the accelerator. You cannot directly say, "Ha, my source abhi banaunga, baad mein dekhenge kidhar lagane ka hai." It's not like that. The source is designed for a particular mechanism of acceleration. And once you have obtained the beam in the accelerator, after extraction and injection into some region, basically you can have RF cavities for acceleration. You can have focusing magnets which are quadrupole magnets. This is an actual quadrupole magnet. You can see four coils dikh raha hai. And these are the four poles. By the way, these coils for conventional magnets are usually, there is a standard nowadays, they are usually hollow, and inside that hollow through the center normally a cooling fluid, usually water, is circulated, because to continuously take away the heat generated by the I square R kind of heat loss from the coil, so that the magnet does not overheat. Okay, so when you pass high current, the currents in typical magnets can go to 40 50 60 100 amperes and so on. I'll show you some real figures when we come to the CERN, some discussion about CERN and all, but it can go so high as that. Okay, even for example, some chota magnet, chota means not so chota, means it is like 800 kilograms weight magnet, but I am calling it chota, that is chota in accelerator standards, and uska typical current is around 40 50 amperes, huh? Understand this unit. So even if the resistance is small, I square R will be huge amount of power loss. So continuously this magnet coils have to be cooled. You can see that these tubes are actually water carrying tubes, and they pass through the hollow part of this magnet, means the coil. Each wire is not a wire, it is actually a hollow tube, because the current is carried only by the skin layer usually. So the remaining part of the inner layer is used for, the hole is used for circulating water. Similarly, this is a bending magnet. Typical size is around 8 meters or something like that. Huge one. So you can have bending magnets, quadrupole magnets for focusing, and RF cavities type of structures for acceleration. This is actually an Alvarez LINAC cavity, but even RF cavities have a similar kind of structure, not identical, but similar. Okay. So you have RF cavities for acceleration, dipole magnets for bending, and quadrupole magnets for focusing. Not necessarily, but typical in most accelerators, you will come across these components. This is just a comparison between electrostatic and magnetic field for bending. We'll come to one more slide on this in detail in some time. But basically, how does an electrostatic beam bend? Because plate bend the beam. The force is proportional to the electric field, and force is along the electric field direction. So if I want to bend this guy to the right, then I have one plate on the left, one plate on the right, and this positive charge gets attracted towards the negative. So he bends in this direction. And the formula, if you have a look at it, it is R is equal to mv square by qe. This formula is non-relativistic, deliberately so. But you can always write down the relativistic equivalent. It will just be m replaced by gamma m. Okay. So basically, the bending radius is proportional to the square of the velocity. That is, it is proportional to the kinetic energy. If you take a half here, then half mv square is proportional to r. So the bending is proportional to the total energy of the particle. On the other hand, when you take a magnet, if there are north and south pole like this, magnetic field is like this, and bending is perpendicular to the magnetic field. You know this, and the formula for force is F is equal to QVB. And if you compare this with centripetal force, you get R is equal to MV by QB. Again, non-relativistic formula. Relativistic will have a gamma in the numerator. Okay. So R is equal to MV by QB is the radius relation. Here you can see that radius is proportional to the MV, that is the momentum. Okay. So this is often called an energy selector, electrostatic deflector. A magnetic dipole is often called a momentum selector. This is just a terminology, because the radius is proportional to the energy, and here the radius is proportional to the momentum. Okay. This is an actual electrostatic deflector, commercially available from National Electrostatics Corporation. You can see that it has two connectors for these two electrodes, and it can be used to bend the beam. The other way is use a magnetic field. The poles are up and down so that the bending will be left and right, as described here. And this is a typical dipole kind of electromagnet. You can see that these wires are not wires, but actually pipes. And you can see these pipes here, so that water inlet is there and they are continuously cooled, as already described. And these are four hooks for actually carrying this. This magnet might easily be weighing somewhere in the region of 1 ton or so, aspas. Okay. This is from Chinese group accelerator, this photograph. Okay. So you can use either bending magnet or a electrostatic deflector. When to use which, we will come to that in a short while. Okay. The other kind of beam manipulation which is required, apart from bending or guiding the beam, is to focus the beam. So focusing also can be achieved using either electrostatic or magnetic method. The one of the electrostatic methods especially useful for low energy beams is to use something called an Einzel lens. An Einzel lens or electrostatic lens, it works on the following principle. You can see this diagram very clearly, that if these are the electric lines of force from the grounded plate to the center plate, then the ion path will come out like this. This can be rigorously done, but I am not going to do it here. But basically, you can see the bottom line. The ions which are traveling parallel are now focused to one particular point. If you change the voltage on the center plate, the configuration of these field lines changes. Correspondingly, the bending of this ion beam changes, and the focal length will shift forward or backward. This is a diagram showing the three-dimensional diagram of contours for constant potential surfaces, something like that. You can see there are three electrodes, and the electric lines of force will run like this from one to the other. And this is an actual figure of this. This is a AutoCAD type of drawing. And this is the actual thing. You can see that they are identical. So they designed it first on computer, and then they fabricated it and assembled it, and it's the same thing. These pictures are taken from Purdue University, I think their website, or one of their something which is put up by them on the web, something like that. So this is just a practical example of how it looks. First and third electrode are grounded. Second electrode is taken at high voltage through a high voltage connector. Any question at this stage on any of the previous slides? How bending works, how deflection or bending work, or how this kind of focusing works? You can please ask. If not, then let me move quickly further. We are badly, not short of time, but yeah, we are not doing very well with time. The other mechanism which is used for focusing beams is something called a quadrupole. Once again, it can be either an electrostatic quadrupole or a magnetic quadrupole. The idea of a quadrupole is that there are four poles like this. You can see 1, 2, 3, 4 poles are there. And each of these poles is alternatively biased. So in this figure, for example, the left and right poles are having negative bias. Top and bottom poles have positive bias. All surfaces are conducting, and hence the electric lines of force will travel from the positive to the negative. The real bottom line which I want to make the statement in this is that if I have a beam which is traveling close to the center, then basically if it is slightly to the left or right, it experiences a force away from the center. However, if it is up or down, it experiences a force towards the center. So you can get focusing either in the y direction or in the x direction. In this diagram, the field configuration is such that the focusing effect is in the y direction, and in the x direction it is defocusing. Are you able to see the arrows on this diagram?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. If I reverse these voltages, if I make the left and right terminal as positive and right and top and bottom terminal as negative, then this situation will reverse, that the y will be defocusing and x will be focusing. If I want focus in both directions, what is done is people construct these objects called called quadrupole triplets. They have three quadrupoles. You can see this is one quadrupole, four poles are there. Behind that, you can see here actually there is a second pole, and here there is a third pole. So you have one quadrupole followed by a second quadrupole followed by a third quadrupole. First and third quadrupole are half the length of the middle one, and both of them are focusing in the let us say y direction. The middle one will have opposite polarity and it will focus in x direction. This is similar to in geometrical optics. You can have a combination of two convex lenses with one concave lens in between, such that overall effect is giving you focusing effect and there is no other lens defects like chromatism and achromatism and all is not there. Okay. So basically this kind of triplet construction is basically carrying forward from a geometrical optics viewpoint. Just as you saw, the Einzel lens acts as a single lens, which takes a parallel beam and gives you a focused beam. The quadrupole triplet acts like a single combined lens, which will focus both in the x and the y direction. Similarly, the magnetic quadrupole triplets can also be constructed in the same manner. Magnetic field also, if you have north-south alternative at 45 degree angles, then the forces configuration is same as what you saw in the electrostatic case. Either you can get focusing in the x and defocusing in the y, or if you interchange the polarities south-north, then you will get defocusing in the x and focusing in the y direction. Both are possible with both the configuration, that is with electrostatic as well as with magnetic. Details of this kind of thing are given in Wilson's book as well as Willis' book. You can try to read and understand, especially Wilson actually kind of derives this in a crude way. So you can have a look at that. Okay. Finally, we reach here. This is a short problem for all of you to do. So you can try to do this now. Or I will tell you one story for 5 minutes and you can do this later as homework. What do you prefer?
Story.
So, ye homework karenge kya tum log?
यस सर
हाँ सर
और होमवर्क में कुछ कंफ्यूजन आया तो मेरे को पूछो ठीक है बट ट्राई टू द पर्पस ऑफ दिस होमवर्क लेट मी मेक इट क्लियर इज टू इंडिकेट व्हेन विल यू यूज अ इलेक्ट्रोस्टैटिक टाइप ऑफ फोकसिंग एंड बेंडिंग एलिमेंट एंड व्हेन वुड यू यूज अ मैग्नेटिक वन ठीक है सो बेसिकली द प्रॉब्लम इज फॉर डिफरेंट एनर्जीज ऑफ प्रोटॉन और डिफरेंट एनर्जीज ऑफ कार्बन आयन पासिंग थ्रू अ टैंडम एक्सेलरेटर ठीक है these are some numbers of what will be the energy from energy you can find beta you know how to do that from last time and once you know beta you can find out v and you can find out what is qvb okay similarly if you know the electric field and magnetic field are given magnetic field is half tesla and electric field is 50 kilovolt per centimeter these are both very very reasonable kind of values for typical means for example I can have a 100 kilovolt two deflector plate separated by 2 centimeters. Then the electric field will be 50 kilovolt per centimeter. And magnetic field typically I can always produce half a Tesla. These are typical values of what you expect when you have an electrostatic or a magnetic type of what you say beamline element or component. Okay. So the purpose of this is that to compare what will be the electric force at this energy compared to what will be the magnetic force at this energy same for this energy same for this energy same for this energies of carbon ion carbon may do not forget the mass is different and therefore velocity to energy conversion will be different when you do it okay and the bottom line I want is at which energy you will switch from using electrostatic components and start using magnetic components the common sense answer is whenever magnetic force is more than electrostatic force that time onwards it is easier to use magnetic you know that magnetic force keeps on increasing with velocity electrostatic force is always constant it only depends on charge so as you increase velocity at some stage v cross b magnitude will be more than the magnitude of this I just want you to tell me when is a good time to switch from electrostatic to magnetic we'll discuss the answer to this question during the tutorial whenever we have some tutorial is that okay or during next lecture something like that now I'll tell you the story is basically when I was in TIFR earlier days when I was basically your age kind of like probably 10-12 years something back 13 years something like that so at that time I was in this TIFR group where we were constructing this accelerator from scratch I mean, nothing was there in the room and then dheere dheere accelerator banaya So I just wanted to share that experience with you. I have few photographs of that from those days. I dug it out from somewhere. Okay. So basically, there are two important components of this accelerator. One is the ECR ion source, which is on the figure or the picture on the left. Picture on the right. And then there is a bending magnet, which is in the picture on the left. The ECR ion source is a permanent magnet ion source, which is at TIFR. And its weight is around 250 to 300 kilograms, somewhere in that range. So it looks small, but it's extremely heavy because it's fully iron or some cobalt kind of material magnets. And the magnet, the electromagnet weight is around 800 kilograms. You can see this object. We are moving it with a crane over here. Okay. So I'll just show you the pictures of how we set up this and what all practical difficulties come when you are actually setting up or assembling some accelerator components. Okay. So this is the original electromagnet which was there, and we had built a crane system for lifting it up and then putting it on the high voltage deck or table. The high voltage deck is basically a metal table. Which is isolated from the ground using some insulators. I'll come to another picture of that in a moment. The purpose of this is that high voltage deck entire thing is going at a voltage of around 300 kilovolt. So obviously you want it well isolated from the ground, and that is why we wanted to place the magnet on top of the deck. So we had this crane, we lifted it up, and we found that this height is too small to bring the magnet on the deck. We need more height. So then we tried to put it directly, then tried to make it work somehow, lift it up little bit, but there is a stand below the magnet which was not fitting at that point. Okay. By the way, let me also tell you a few things about the people in the photograph. Maybe here. This is Professor Lokesh Tribedi on the left most. And he is basically the leader of this group in TIFR. He is my guide also for my PhD. Okay. And he was the one who got this ECR ion source, etc. from his research grant. Then this is Dr. Aditya Narayan Agnihotri, who is right now a professor at IIT Delhi. This is Dr. Aditya Kelkar behind him, who is a professor at IIT Kanpur. And he is in charge of an accelerator facility in Kanpur right now. In the right hand side photograph, the person behind the magnet on that side is Dr. Shyamal Chatterjee. He was a postdoc at that time in that group. And now he is in IIT Bhubaneswar. He is a professor there. And he works nowadays on biomaterials, etc. Some of those things. Well, I told you that we were not able to lift the magnet. So then wo crane ke niche we had to put this concrete bricks. So we lifted up the crane on concrete bricks dire dire, so that the height got increased. Then we were able to lift the magnet and then we placed it on the stand. These are the insulators which I was talking about, where it is isolating the deck from the ground so that you can put the deck on 400 kilovolt power supply. You can see that there is a spirit level to check whether the leveling is proper and so on so forth. Then we took up the ion source. A few more people in this photograph. So this is Mr. Chauhan ji. He retired from TIFR like almost 7-8 years back. This is another of the staff at TIFR was Mr. C.A. Desai. He passed away from heart problem sometimes earlier. And the person who is here is Professor Nyayate, who is from actually Thana College. Some of you may be knowing him. I don't know. And Prime right now he yeah, so you may know, you may be knowing Nyayate sir, na? Sometimes.
Yes.
And even Bapat sir is there in another photograph. Okay. This is Dr. Bapat from from Bandodkar College. Yes. Yeah, you know Bapat sir. So he is also there. Okay, then good. So you found some familiar face. Then this is Dr. Sushil Samant. He did his PhD from CBS and BRC, and he is working in simulations for electron accelerators for plasma-based electron accelerators. Interesting kind of simulation work he does. So a lot of people and a lot of things, you know, memories. Of course, you might have spotted me in few photographs. I didn't point out, but you may have spotted me. And then this is the ECR ion source. First, we tied it up with this chain. It is a special chain. It is non-magnetic because this is a permanent magnet. Anything metallic or magnetic, it will go and stick on that. We faced a huge problem. That is why this is covered up with, this is the plasma chamber inside. We covered it with aluminium foil because these screws and all used to suddenly get attracted on that because it's a permanent magnet kind of thing. So anyway, we managed to, and there is a rubber kind of crane also, means this hook is magnetic. So we lifted it with some rubber kind of thing. And finally, we managed to place it on the high voltage deck. You can see this rubber thing because this is iron. So we tried to, with one rubber belt of some machine, we tried to lift this. This is 300 kilos, dikhta nahi hai, but it's very heavy. Okay, this is basically from start. When I had entered that lab in TIFR in 2007-8 sometimes, this was the status of the lab. Basically, they were just putting the ceramic pillars for the deck. Then we put the deck. Actually, I was there when we actually put the deck. And then this is a stand for the electromagnet and this is a stand for the ECR ion source. Then this is photograph taken after placing the electromagnet. You saw all the Ramayana which we went through for placing. You can see those concrete bricks are still lying there on which we had supported that crane pulley, lifted it up so that we could place this magnet. Then this is after putting the ECR ion source. You can see that here also the crane pulley is actually mounted on this concrete bricks. Okay. Then we started mounting other components. These are some supporting stands. After that, this is actually something called a Faraday cup. which is used for measuring the beam current, and this is a turbo pump which will provide vacuum in this region. So we had mounted this, then we connected this, then the ECR ion source also we connected at that time. This was around the time when this was open and one screw went inside, then we had to spend a long time trying to bring it out. Because if you put your hand inside and try to pick up the screw, it's very difficult to pull out because continuously it is pulling even with your hand. It's a very, very strong magnet. It's a 2 Tesla permanent magnet. So we had put a kind of plastic here so that nothing will happen. With 2 screws, we had fixed it so that nothing will go inside. This is a Einzel lens for, and there is an extractor electrode also. This is the extractor electrode and the ECR ion source will fit on this. This was mounted on a track, so actually it will move forward. So this is the extractor electrode, and then there is an Einzel lens inside this, which will focus the beam. Then the beam passes through this magnet and then comes out from here, out of the page, basically. That is the how it will, that is how it was configured. It still is like that only in TIFR. It's the same way. This is after mounting the vacuum gauge controllers, the ECR power supply, the magnet power supply. This is the magnet power supply. It's almost as big as the magnet itself, almost as heavy also. The power supply requires separate water cooling, otherwise it will not work. And there is a waveguide for, there is a microwave source for the ECR. This is the waveguide which is here. It is not connected right now, but that was placed over here. So finally, everything was enclosed nicely. This is a cascade generator like a Cockcroft-Walton type to give 400 kilovolt on this deck. And this intermediate stage is there for half of that voltage. This is a accelerating column so that the end of the tube is at ground potential and this end is at 400 kilovolt. And the ECR ion source generates the ions. It is bent through this bending magnet and comes here, and then people do experiments today. So if you go to TIFR today, you will find even more. Some of these panels have been removed and a lot of other changes. But basically, this dome structure is still intact. This power supply is still used and so on. So this is like almost 7-8 years back, or not seven, maybe 5-6 years back. Even now, they are still using the same kind of things. This was just the story in the sense how you can experience building up a accelerator from scratch. So this is where you start. Then gradually you put one components and then you build up dhire dhire. Then finally you have this, then you are a little bit happy. Haan, chalo, kuch toh ho gaya. Now we can do some experiment on this. So all this development took place over several months and it was very interesting. Just wanted to share that with you guys. I don't know how much I managed to convey, but it's very exciting when you are actually working. It's real fun. Just wanted to tell you. Basic takeaway lesson from today's class: 3 major working concepts or working aspects in accelerator: acceleration, bending, focusing. Ye tino kaisa karne ka malum pad gaya to you are through. Low energies, normally electrostatic acceleration as well as bending focusing is also using electrostatic components, but at higher energies the acceleration is more better using AC type acceleration because of size constraints. And the focusing and bending are done by magnetic components such as magnetic dipole bending magnet and magnetic quadrupole for the focusing. These are the basic 3 takeaway lessons, apart from many other things which we saw like ion source and so on. All these are of course there. Okay. So thank you very much. Sorry for overshooting my time by around 15 minutes. Sorry about that. You get less break for next class. Sorry. Okay. I think quickly we can close down this lecture, so that you guys can carry on with your further classes and so on. Okay. Is that okay?
Yes, sir.
Anything else? Anything else? We'll take it up next time.
Okay. Okay, sir.
Yeah. Chalo. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.